research, the creative power behind the modern world, building the future in the laboratory. The industrial chemist determining a carbon percentage for a safety steel. The physicist analyzing colored light rays for signal lenses. The plant breeder pollinating selected grasses for mountain pastures. These men are applying the laws of science to everyday problems. And research into the behavior of electromagnets has revolutionized the telephone system and introduced the dial. In the laboratories of Dollis Hill, they are testing specimen telephones for the dial system. First, a volume test by comparison with a standard instrument.
One, two, three, four, five. 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 One, two, three, four, five.
Second, a durability test on the receivers of candlestick telephones. Third, a test of transmission and reception efficiency to determine the sensitivity of the latest type of instrument. This sound is made by an oscillator covering the entire frequency range of the human voice in the space of a second. It's a synthetic voice, telling the engineer how every word of every language will sound through the telephone under test. The gauge before him is measuring its efficiency in units of sound volume, decibels. Ever since 1879, when the first English telephone exchange was opened at Manchester, the switchboards have been designed for manual working. The coming of the dial demands a new network of exchanges to house the delicate mechanisms which convert impulses into telephone calls. These statistics, collected over years of telephone practice, tell the designer how much conversational traffic each new exchange must handle, and at what times of the day it will be heaviest. So he calculates the particular needs of each district in terms of traffic averages and telephone densities. On this basis, the plans for each new exchange are drawn. So the plans of the draftsmen take shape in steel and concrete, and new buildings appear against the London sky. Here, between St. Paul's and the river, the old order is changing. The complexities of modern business and modern commerce demand the closest contact between office and warehouse, buyer and seller, wholesaler and retailer, stockbroker and investor, and between people who simply want to talk to each other. New methods replace old, and this building rises above the city to act as the nerve center of a new system of communication. 15 feet below the streets, the wires from every part of the city emerge from the earth to the new exchange. They come from the offices, the banks, the shops, the distant exchanges, linking every part of the city together. Countless pairs of tiny wires, protected in stout, lead-sheathed cables. Leading up from under the city, through the silent cable chamber, through the floors of the exchange, millions of wires representing telephone access to the entire world. Here, on the distribution frame, is the converging point of 10,000 pairs of private telephone lines. And this delicate complexity of switches and contacts, relays and impulse machines, is the mechanism behind the dial. It has been evolved through years of patient research into the mysteries of magnetic control. And it is the answer of the mathematician and the engineer to the modern demands for speed and organization. ...19,000 switches in a single exchange. From 72 to 600 contacts on every switch. And post office engineers must examine every contact before the apparatus can be passed as perfect. Each of the three moving arms of the switch must make perfect connection with both the upper and lower surfaces of the contact, or transmission and reception will be faulty. So the engineer uses an ordinary dental mirror to aid him in his examination. 19,000 switches controlled from the 10 finger holes on the dial, and every switch must be tested out on each dial level. No ordinary room lights will reveal the minute details of this mechanism. Every engineer in the automatic exchange wears a headlamp, throwing a direct beam in his line of sight. Eight and a half million soldered connections, and each connection is checked carefully over, for this machinery will work 24 hours a day and 7 days a week, clattering on year after year until new electrical discoveries replace it. In the top floor switch room of the exchange is the only vestige of human control. However perfect the mechanical system may be, human frailties must still be taken into account. This is the personal service still available behind the rattle and buzz of the switches. But the old equipment of manual working, plugs, jacks and keys, has disappeared, superseded by the ordered banks of automatic apparatus. A new telephone system has replaced the old. When the receiver is lifted, You're automatically connected to a series of switches in your local exchange. As you begin to dial, the first of these switches comes into operation. It interprets the first letter of the exchange you're calling. Now this switch selects from the thousands of wires available one pair which will carry your call to the distant exchange. Now you dial out the number you want. And as you do so, this mechanical operator comes into play. It stores up the electrical impulses from the dial until the switches in the distant exchange are ready to receive them. Then it flashes the impulses from the dial along the wires, figure by figure, switch by switch. First, the thousands. Next, the hundreds. Then the tens. And finally, the digits. In this way, one telephone out of the 750,000 in the London district is selected. And these are the automatic alarms. In this way, every human mistake and every disturbance of efficiency are reported to the engineers. In London, as in every modern city, communications are the life arteries of commerce. Once more, the laws of science have been applied to an everyday problem. And this dial system is a vital contribution to efficiency and speed.